But even this simple system, if you want to solve it fully analytically, is a little bit complex. So let's make it more simple to introduce the concept of vibration mode. If the stiffness of the three springs is the same, and if the two mass are identical, then the system is much simpler, and we have an impedance matrix that is 2k minus omega square m on the diagonal and minus k for the off-diagonal terms. So resonances of the system will occur when the determinant of this impedance matrix is equal to zero. And I invite you to do the full calculation by yourself, but it's easy to write the characteristic polynomial to find the solutions for omega square, and from there to find the solution for omega 1 and omega 2. And we see that we have two resonance frequencies, one that is square root of k over m, and one that is square root of 3k over m. Now, how does the system behave? How do the two mass move with respect to one another at each of these frequencies? So to do that, we have to replace omega by, for instance, square root of k over m, and we then see that the system of equation becomes k times u1 minus k times u2 is equal to zero, and the same thing for the second equation. And we see that we have an infinite number of solutions for that, because any solution where the two mass are moving in phase with exactly the same amplitude is going to be a solution at that frequency. We call that type of displacement the mode, the vibration mode, associated to the resonance pulsation square root of k over m. And if we take the second resonance frequency, we replace omega by square root of 3k over m, we see that the equation become k times u1 plus k times u2 is equal to zero. And so any displacement where the two mass are going to move out of phase is going to be a possible motion at that pulsation square root of 3k over m. Without getting into too much detail, it's maybe worth to try to understand what is happening at these two frequencies and why we have these modes. So let's look again at the system, and we have the two mass moving in phase. If they are moving in phase with the same displacement, the spring between these two is irrelevant. It's never compressed, never elongated, plays no role in the system. And so everything happens as if each mass was on its own connected to a single spring of stiffness k, and so the system resonates at the frequency square root of k over m, which is the same as the single degree of freedom system. If we look at the second mode, where the two mass are moving out of phase, and if you look at the system from the point of view of a single mass, you see that it is connected to a spring k to the ground, but that the second spring, whenever you move one mass, you also move the other, so the actual spring stiffness of the second spring, the spring in between, is 2k. So everything happens as if each mass was connected to two springs, one with stiffness k, one with stiffness 2k, and so the total stiffness is 3k, and the resonance frequency is square root of 3k over m. Modes are extremely important in the analysis of dynamic systems, because they are a natural descriptors of the vibrating motion of the dynamic behavior of the system. Let me explain. For the two degree of freedom system, we have the system of equation that is shown here, the one that we just analyzed. Now, let's try to see if we can define the displacement not mass by mass, but rather mode by mode. If we can express the displacement vector u1, u2 as a linear combination of the individual modes that I called phi1 and phi2, and we'd have component phi11, phi12, phi21, and phi22. So the matrix that I call here the modal matrix is just a matrix in which I have placed one mode at in every column, first mode, second column. And if I can express the displacement U1, U2 as this model matrix times another vector whose components I called the model participation factor. So I try to express the displacement as a linear combination of the modes, and the coefficients of that linear combination are called the model participation factor or the model displacement, and whatever is modal will be written with little hat on top. So hat U1 is the modal displacement associated to mode 1. Now, if we put that into the system of equation, we obtain the following, which is not very interesting. It only becomes interesting if we now pre-multiply that equation by the transpose of the modal matrix. Follow me, you'll see why we do that. If we do that, this is what we get, and it doesn't seem more interesting nor more simple, but it only becomes interesting if you know, and this will be demonstrated elsewhere, so just take it as a property and trust me on that, that this triple product of the transpose of the modal matrix times the mass matrix times the modal matrix gives me a diagonal matrix whose coefficient on the diagonal are called M1, hat M1 and hat M2. These are called the modal masses. So you have to see that in an algebraic way, in a vector space way, if you project the mass matrix in the modal space, you get a diagonal matrix with coefficient m hat 1 and m hat 2. What is more striking is that exactly the same applies to the stiffness matrix. If we do the same transformation, if we project the stiffness matrix in the modal space, we also get a diagonal matrix, and the coefficients are k hat 1, k hat 2. They are called the modal stiffness. Now, if you remember, I said that the modes were defined up to a multiplication constant. And so I can choose the amplitude of the mode in the way I want. And there's one classical choice, it's just a convention. There's one classical choice which consists in choosing the amplitude of the mode so that the modal mass is unity. We say that we normalize the modes with respect to the mass matrix. And what is amazing is that if we do that choice, the stiffness matrix also becomes very simple. We just have on the diagonal the square of the resonance pulsation that are called the eigenvalues of the system. So doing all these transformations, just projecting the entire system of equation in the modal space, we get a very simple system of equation, which says that a diagonal matrix, omega 1 square minus omega square and omega 2 square minus omega square on the diagonal, nothing for the off-diagonal terms, multiplying the modal displacement, also called the modal participation factor, is equal to a modified force vector, which is the projection of the force vector on the modes, which is called the modal force vector. And so we have replaced, by projecting the system of equation in the modal space, we have created a very simple system of equation, which is diagonal, where the 2 degrees of freedom that we now choose, which is the amplitude of mode 1, amplitude of mode 2, are totally decoupled. This probably seems extremely mathematical, but physically it's also very interesting and has a direct interpretation in the physical domain, that if you take a 2 degrees of freedom system, and if instead of the mass you consider the modal mass, instead of the stiffness you consider the modal stiffness, instead of the force you consider the modal forces, and instead of the displacement you consider the modal displacements, well, you have an amazing result, is that the two individual degrees of freedom are totally decoupled. Everything happens as if the two degree of freedom system was just the independent combination of two single degrees of freedom system with the properties that are shown here. Now, I didn't talk about damping, I tried to avoid damping, but I have to say a word about damping. Damping, if there is some dissipation in all the connection between the mass, well, this is unfortunately going to change. Because if you project damping into the model space, there will be damping attached to mass 1, there will be damping attached to mass 2, they will be called modal damping. But unfortunately, there will also be a modal damping component that connects mode 1 and mode 2, so that the total independence is going to be lost unless we make special hypotheses.